mga kababayang mahirap at walang matakbuhan. At nangako po kayo under oath na walang matatanggihan na pasyente na lumalapit sa malasakit centers at sa mga pampublikong ospital. You assure the commission na talagang tutulungan natin ang mga mahirap at nangangailangan using all the funds given to the Department of Health by the legislature. Maraming salamat po sa inyong pagmamalasakit sa ating mga kababayan, Secretary. Do you confirm this, Mr. Secretary?
Good morning, Mr. Chair. Yes, I confirm that we will support the malasakit centers, over 100 plus in many of the hospitals of the Department of Health, and will continue to provide assistance to our indigent patients.
Maraming salamat, Secretary. And additionally, the Secretary also mentioned that super health centers will be supported by the department as it is in line with the universal health care law. No? Can we continue to count on your support for this initiative? Dahil dito po sa mga health centers na ito, dyan na po may implement yung primary care ng universal health care. At since tumaas na po yung budget ng PhilHealth no for next year sa proposed budget, ay mas malalong may implement po yung konsulta package ng gobyerno. And it will help decongest the hospitals dahil dyan na po sila magpapa-check up, early disease detection, at hindi na lumala yung sakit, lalong-lalo na po ngayon na tumataas po yung cases ng flu, influenza. Maaari bang makumpirma natin na malaking tulong po itong mga health super health centers, lalong-lalo na po sa mga malalayong lugar na walang access po sa hospitals?
Yes, Mr. Chair. I confirm our priority is developing and improving primary care by building more primary care facilities or super health centers with laboratory, ultrasound, x-ray, even probably dialysis and even birthing to support the decongestion of our hospitals, Mr. Chair.
Salamat. Last Congress, we passed Republic Act 11712 or the Public Health Emergency Benefits and Allowances for Healthcare Workers, sponsored by the Finance Chair, Senator Angara. We provided for benefits and compensation to our healthcare workers and frontliners. Alam natin na hindi mababayaran ng kahit anuman po yung buhay at sakripisyo na binigay po ng ating mga frontliners. No? Ito po ay services rendered. Pinagpawisan na po ito ng ating mga medical frontliners. At sa kakaikot ko sa buong Pilipinas, marami talaga nag-aabot sa akin ng papel, nanawagan, secretly inaabot sa akin yung papel, pagbasa ko, sir, yung aming heya, no? Yun parati ko talagang natatagpuan ko, anywhere, any hospital, heya ang panawagan nila. At alam ko naman pong ginagawa nyo rin po ang lahat, no? Kaya nanawagan ako sa Department of Health, sa DBM, kung meron pong bondo, whether a program, whether unprogram, ay sana po mabigyan po ito ng priority. 2021 pa yung iba rito, 2022. Ika nga, services rendered na po ito, pinagpawisan na po nila ito. May we know from the good secretary, ano na pong updates dito since during the budget deliberation, nabanggit niyo po na meron na disburse na po yung 23 billion no para sa for this year dito sa health emergency allowances ng ating mga healthcare workers.
Yes, Mr. Chair, the Department of Budget and Management released earlier this year 4 billion pesos which we have distributed. I heard almost disbursed na ito, so we requested another tranche depending on availability of funds at mabigay natin sa ating mga healthcare workers, Mr. Chair.
Salamat po. Baka pwedeng mabigyan ka agad ng prioridad po ito. Sabi ko nga sa unprogram o program funds. Dahil inaantay po ito. Nakikiusap po ako sa inyo. Inaantay po ito ng ating mga medical frontliners 2021, 2022, 2023 services rendered na po ito. At Ito, from Lawag, may sumulat po sa akin sa kanilang claims, no? And going to another issue, ito pong rising cases of influenza. Ito pong walking pneumonia, there are reports of a surge in cases of respiratory illnesses in China. The Netherlands has also reported cases related to the bacteria that causes a walking pneumonia. We need to have response measures in place against possible increases in cases here in the country. And in fact, kaya nga po tayo naka-online na po, no? Bumalik na rin po kami sa online session, some of our members, dahil nagkasakit rin po, no? Tita Sincha, get well po. Magandang umaga. Good morning, Ma'am Sincha. Naka-mute po. Magandang umaga, Ma'am Sincha. Gusto mong batiin sila?
Good morning. I am here attending online.
Kumusta po kayo? Okay naman po.
Okay na.
Get well po.
Okay, thank you.
Ayun po, no? Tumataas yung kaso. At dapat po ay matuto tayo sa nangyari sa atin during the COVID-19 pandemic. Lessons learned tayo dito. At ikaw po ay naging malaking parte nung COVID response natin. Of course, ang lahat ng ating mga Department of Health officials, Yusek Barrere, dito sila Doc Jack Arroyo. Salamat po sa inyong sakripisyo sa panahon ng pandemya. Tayo natin masayang yung pinaghirapan nating lahat. Ikaw po ang naging special advisor. What measures is the DOH undertaking and are you recommending to mitigate cases and avoid an outbreak here in the Philippines, Secretary?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Totoo po, not only in China but now other countries in Europe have reported increase in respiratory illness in children. Attributed po ito sa hindi bagong virus, previous microbes, Mycoplasma pneumonia, yung respiratory syncytial virus at saka yung influenza. Sa Philippines po, wala pang outbreak according to our Epidemiology Bureau, although marami ang cases because ito po talaga yung season ng respiratory illness. And my advice is the same. Yung natutunan natin ng COVID, yung social distancing at saka pagsuot ng face mask, cough etiquette para hindi magkahawahan. Kung may sakit ang bata, huwag nang papasukin para hindi makahawa ng ibang bata sa eskwelahan, Mr. Chair.
Though hindi na po mandatory ang pagsusuot ng face mask sa ngayon, ako bilang chair po ng Committee on Health, iniinganyo ko pa rin po ang ating mga kababayan, kundi naman po sa gabal sa inyo. At natutuwa ako tuwing may nakikita po akong nagsusuot pa rin po ng face mask, no? Lalo-lalo na po yung mga merong comorbidities na maaring mahawa. And lastly, Mr. Secretary, to recognize the significant contribution of overseas Filipinos, mga modern day heroes natin ito, yung contributions nila sa ating bansa, and to further enhance reintegration efforts of the government for OFWs. Former President Duterte issued Executive Order Number 154 in 2021, establishing the OFW Hospital in Pampanga. The hospital is envisioned to provide comprehensive and total health care services to all OFWs and their dependents. I have also filed Senate Bill 2297 to institutionalize the OFW Hospital and ensure its continuous operations. Currently, OFW Hospital is being managed by the Department of Migrant Workers. However, there are concerns on its technical capability in managing a hospital. Do you think it is better for the DOH to manage the DOH hospitals? Dahil ito naman po ang inyong expertise, Mr. Secretary.
Yes, Mr. Chair, we welcome any assistance that will be requested by the Department of Migrant Workers to help operationalize and improve the services of our OFW hospital in Pampanga.
I have also filed Senate Bill 2414 to establish OFW wards in DOH hospitals. At hindi naman lahat ng OFWs makakapunta sa hospital sa Pampanga. I understand that DOH already has a policy on OFW wards. Ilan hospital na po ay meron na po mga OFW wards at ilan po ang OFWs ay naserbisyuhan na po dito. At ito pong sa PhilHealth natin, since mag-increase tayo ng budget for next year, dalawang side po itong naririnig ko kasi, Mr. Secretary, matagal na pong issue ang unpaid claims ng PhilHealth sa mga private hospitals. Nakakausap ko po ang PhilHealth at private hospitals noon, no? During ito pong kay Philippine a Private Hospitals Association of the Philippines President Dr. Jose de Grano noon pang panahon ni Pangulong dating Pangulong Duterte. At pinapaalalahanan ko noon ang pamunuan ng PhilHealth na ayusin po ang mga issue sa mga apektadong hospital at makipag-ugnayan sa mga grupo tulad ng PAPI para maresolba. Hindi pwedeng maantala ang serbisyong pangkalusugan para sa mga tao. Hindi lang naman po ang malalaking hospital ang inaasahan ng mga kababayan natin, no? May mga maliliit na hospitals na kailangan rin po nila ng puhunan para po maka tuloy-tuloy po ang kanilang operasyon. According to reports, 27 billion worth of claims remain unpaid as of end of September 2023. As chairman of the PhilHealth Board, gusto nating malaman kung ano na po ang status nito at ano po ang rekomendasyon ng niyo sa PhilHealth bilang chairman, no, para mapabuti at mapabilis ang pagbabayad sa mga private hospitals, Secretary.
Yes, Mr. Chair. We have actually asked the management of PhilHealth already start paying, and they have promised to pay arrears of more than 60 days in a period of 90 days. I think marami ng hospitals ang nabayaran. We continue to request the management to improve the services so that the claims will be given immediately. And we've also asked PhilHealth management to provide more benefits, health benefits in primary care, not only hospital benefits, to actually improve the services of PhilHealth to help our universal health coverage, Mr. Chair.
I am also reminding PhilHealth to exert all efforts possible in accordance with our laws. Naintindihan ko naman po nung nagkaroon ng investigasyon dito sa Senado at talagang pinag-iingatan po ng PhilHealth rin po ang pondo, no? Dahil sila po ang nag-isa dito sa hearing sa Senado. Kaya lang po nakikiusap ako kung pwede po mapabilisan, masimplihan, mas iklian po ang proseso sa tulong po ng teknolohiya at dagdag na tao kung kakailanganin po. Importante rito, walang masayang na pondo po ng gobyerno ni piso. At para hindi rin po maantala ang operasyon ng ating mga hospitals, no? At ito naman pong sabi ko kanina sa other side naman po, merong mga doctors, no, na in 2019, nagkaroon tayo ng hearing dito sa Senado tungkol sa fraudulent claims sa PhilHealth. Tulad ng upcasing at overpayment, kinukundina po natin yung mga ganitong gawain at sinusuportahan natin ang PhilHealth sa mga hakbang nito para maiwasan po ito. Having said that, may mga lumalapit sa aking opisina na yung mga maliliit na hospital at doktor na tinanggalan po ng accreditation ng PhilHealth dahil sa mga maliliit at na pagkakamali sa filing ng claims. Ang events, honest mistake po siguro itong iba at wrongfully filed claims. Yung iba talaga maliit na halaga lang ang pagkakamali pero sinususpindi po sila agad ng PhilHealth for 6 months, paano naman po yung kanilang trabaho, yung kanilang hanap buhay. Even yung iba dyan ay 400 pesos. Ano po ang proseso ng PhilHealth sa pag-verify ng ganito at paano magiging action ng PhilHealth kung malaman na fraudulent o mali yung claim? At dapat may threshold na amount po involved kung kailangan papatawan ng suspension ang accreditation ng health facility o doktor. Even yung iba po ay umahabot sa korte. Mas mahal pa yung gastos nila sa bugado sa araw-araw na pag-asikaso at saka yung perwiso po sa kanilang pamumuhay, sobrang apektado, pati po ang sa kanilang pamilya, apektado rin po dito. So baka tingnan niyo po ito ng mabuti, Mr. Secretary.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Yung mga hospital and doctors na nagkakaroon ng penalty ay nag-a-appeal naman po at umaabot sa board. The current board has become more humanistic in terms of the decisions and have actually approved some of the requests as long as there is no malicious intent. So hinahanap namin pa rin ang fraud. We are asking management to continue to look and go after fraudulent practices, but we are also knowledgeable na merong mga over ang kanilang penalty and the board has acted on several of them, Mr. Chair.
Are they guided sa mga hakbang na maaari nilang gawin para sa pag-apila ng desisyon? Yung iba po, some are 15 years ago pa po yung cases nila and then all of a sudden, nandyan na po yung desisyon and they were advised na to go to court na lang po ang kanilang pag-asa dito. And even now, for mga pagkakamali nila na 400 pesos, ika nga, and then papatawan sila ng 6 months sa suspension. Dapat po siguro maging guided sila sa gagawin nilang hakbang para hindi na po umabot sa ganong sitwasyon na wala na silang ibang recourse but to go to the court.
Yeah, that's correct, Mr. Chair. So we have actually, the board has ordered the management to review these rules, these penalty rules for, like I said, wrong claims or whatever. And we will be reviewing that and they will be presenting to the board how to penalize such clerical errors. Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Senator JV,
With your indulgence regarding this matter also, regarding your fraudulent claims, we investigated years ago fraudulent claims, yung upcasing, yung cataract scam regarding PhilHealth. Ang just want to ask Mr. Secretary if kailan siguro may prosecute talaga, no? It's really Mr. Chair, it's a collusion, no, between PhilHealth employees, some doctors in some hospitals. So what can the good secretary commit that under his leadership in the PhilHealth that they would really seek justice, no? Because the funds of PhilHealth, hindi tayo mayamang bansa, dapat mapunta ito doon sa talagang nararapat. So would you also believe that those who are really involved in this kind of scams really has to be brought to justice so that talagang pondo ng PhilHealth mapunta doon sa tama?
Mr. Chair, I agree. We should go after malicious fraudulent claims, and both hospitals and doctors that are guilty should actually be penalized, Mr. Chair.
I agree with Senator JV, you know. At wala pong dapat masayang na pera ng gobyerno ni piso, dahil dapat po'y mga mahihirap nating kababayan ang makikinabang dito since in-increase po natin ang pondo po ng PhilHealth for next year. Napakalaki po ng increase. So kung sino po yung may kasalanan, makasuhan, kaya nga po tayo nag-hearing dito sa Senado, tingnan ng mabuti kung sino po yung may kagagawa ng kalokohan, makakasuhan kaagad. At yung wala naman pong kasalanan, ay baka ma-absuelto nyo naman po. Balansihin lang po ng mabuti. The truth, kung ano lang po yung totoo at kung sino po yung may kasalanan. Kasi may mga sitwasyon po din sa mga public hospitals na tinatanggalan po ng accreditation dahil sa mga wrongfully filed claims. Hindi natin maiwasan na makukompromiso po yung accessibility sa medical services, lalong-lalo na po sa mga malalayong lugar na wala masyadong public hospitals, tapos mawawalan pa ng PhilHealth accreditation ng health facility doon. At since lahat po ng Pilipino ay membro po ng PhilHealth, hindi naman po lahat ma-access ang serbisyo dahil walang PhilHealth accredited health facility. So, yun po ang dapat nating balansihin po, Mr. Secretary, dahil halos lahat po ng Pilipino ay umaasa po sa PhilHealth, whether private, small private hospitals or government hospitals. Halos PhilHealth talaga ang last stop dyan parate. So, yun lang po. Pakitingnan lang po ng mabuti. That is all, Mr. Secretary. Again, we expect that you will stay true to your commitments and count on your leadership to ensure that we can further improve our healthcare system and assist all patients needing assistance. Salamat po, Mr. Secretary, sa inyong commitment at sa inyong dedication sa inyong trabaho. May we recognize our majority floor leader.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. A query sa secretariat. Reports committed to be submitted to the body, were they submitted? Secretary Mayra? Yung report on improvements to public hospitals and data on additional specialty centers and relevant data regarding malasakit, were they submitted? Just a query.
Yes, Mr. Majority Floor Leader, all those requested documents were submitted.
Thank you. On the part of the House contingent, while we have a lot more policy questions that our members want to, you know, ask, we are confident that the Honorable Secretary will address most of these concerns even after these deliberations. So on the part of the House contingent, Mr. Chair, we will no longer ask any questions to further expedite the deliberation. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Salamat, Majority Floor Leader. From our contingent naman po sa Senado, may we recognize Senator Risa Hontiveros. Ma'am, go ahead po.
Salamat kaayo, Mr. Chair, at magandang umaga po, Secretary.
Magandang umaga, ma'am.
Salamat, sir. One of the SONA commitments of the President is to release the long overdue allowances and benefits of healthcare workers who worked at the height of COVID-19. Mr. Secretary, ang akin pong opisina ay patuloy din na nakatatanggap ng reklamo patungkol sa health emergency allowance, yung HEA. Some reports have alleged that government owes our HCWs around 26 billion pesos for unpaid allowances and benefits. Narinig ko po yung sinabi ni Secretary kanina na may na-release na 4 na billion. So, medyo malayo pa yung pupunuin para makumpleto yung sinasabing 26 billion. So, maaari po bang itanong, Mr. Secretary, ilang claims pa o anong halaga pa ng mga claims that remain unsettled? Magkano po yon? At ano yung timetable para i-settle yung remaining claims?
Thank you, Ma'am Chair. Mr. Chair, ang GAA for 2022 na disbursed na nila is 22 billion para sa health emergency allowance. Yung sinasabi kong 4 billion is for the 2023 General Appropriations Act. Ang na-allocate doon was 27 billion and nagre-release na tayo unti-unti as the Department of Budget and Management releases this to us. So ang disbursement yun, based on what is given, almost 90.9% dispersed na yung unang releases. So ang total claims na nag-grant na po ay 8,040,980. So for the total, parang ang total po ay 72 billion po ang total talaga na dapat bayaran. Ang unprogram po ay 52 billion. So for this year sa GAA, 19 ang naka-program at 52 yung mga nasa unprogram. So we are awaiting release. I have requested DBM to also release so that our healthcare workers will be given their due benefits, Madam Chair.
Salamat, Mr. Secretary. So, klaruhin ko lang para pong malinaw sa akin, malinaw din po sa mga healthcare workers na nakikinig sa atin. So, sabi niyo po, 2022, yung nasa GAA was 22 billion pesos. Yung 22B po ba yon para sa 2022? Covered na po lahat nung obligation natin sa mga healthcare workers para sa taong iyon?
Hindi pa, ma'am. Kasi we are asking 25. Ang current request ko po ay 25.96 billion. This is for the November 29 kami sumulat sa DBM to release na this remainder para mabigay sa ating healthcare workers, Madam Chair.
Okay, salamat po, Mr. Secretary. And then para sa 2023, sabi nyo nga po na ang nasa GAA ay 27 billion pesos. Binanggit nyo na 4 billion pesos ay na-allocate na. Pero later may binanggit din po kayong may 90.9% na ang na-release. Was that for year 2023 also?
Yes, Madam Chair.
So for 2023, may less than 10% na lang na utang po natin sa healthcare workers na hindi pa po na-release.
That's correct, Madam Chair.
Salamat, Mr. Secretary. Sabi nyo rin po, total claims granted so far, tama po ba? 8 million or 8 billion? Did I understand?
8 million po. 8 million workers.
B po.
Million. Million workers po. Tao.
Oh, I'm sorry.
8 million persons that claimed.
Alright. Salamat po. I stand corrected. So, 8 million healthcare workers ang nag-grant na po. Out of ilang total ang dapat mabigyan?
I think around 10 million workers itong estimate, ma'am.
So kung gayon, Mr. Secretary, may 2 million pa na kailangan pa nating bayaran yung utang natin ng gobyerno,
yes, Madam
sa
Chair.
Kanila. Salamat po, Mr. Secretary. And then, may binanggit po kayong 72 billion pesos requested, tama po ba? Pero unprogrammed ay 52 billion pesos. Para sa aling taon po iyon?
Madam Chair, for 2023, ang unprogrammed ay 52 billion. Ang NEP na nilagay namin sa budget ng 2024 is 19 billion. So ang total lahat ng dalawa, 52 plus 19 ay 72 billion. Pag nabigay ho lahat yan, covered na natin yung 10 million workers.
And then, meron din kayong binanggit kanina na 90 billion pero 52 billion unprogrammed. Para sa anong taon po iyon?
For GAA 2023, we have allotted 19.7 billion, which was programmed, and 52, which was unprogrammed.
19 po, 19.
Yun yung na-release na sa amin, na-release na ang 4 billion noon.
Okay. And then huli po, sabi nyo nga po, nung itong nakaraang buwan, Nobyembre, may request po kayo na 25.96 billion na iniintay,
yes,
po ma-release po sa department.
Na.
So, overall po, magkano na lang ang unsettled mula po sa unang taon ng pandemya hanggang ngayon? Ilan pong claims ito at ang magkano po yung total na kulang pa nating ibayad?
Ang arrears po namin for 2021, 22, and 23 ay 62.9 billion pa.
At kung gayon, ano po yung timetable para i-settle itong remaining 62B plus?
Sa NEP meron tayong, sa 2024, Madam Chair, naglagay din tayo dyan ng 22 billion, I think. So, unti-unting nababawasan every year. Opo.
So, at this rate po, Mr. Secretary, posibleng natatansya ng department na within 3 years, mababayaran nyo na po lahat ng utang pa nating HEA sa healthcare workers?
Yes, Madam Chair, or shorter, hopefully.
Okay po. So, pwede po natin sabihin sa mga healthcare workers natin at the latest, plano po ng department na by year 2026, kung hindi man mas maaga, makukuha na po nila.
Yes, Madam Chair.
Salamat, Mr. Secretary. And lastly, on this topic, may posibilidad ba na mapaaga pa yung timetable? Sabi niyo po kasi at the latest, within 3 years. At the earliest po, ano yung nakikita niyong kakayaning gawin ng department?
Madam Chair, kasi kung unprogrammed funds, basta may taxes makolect ang national government, the DBM can release us this money. So we're hoping that there will be more taxes paid. And kasi ang sabi nila, konti ang na-collect noong 2021-2022. And that's the reason hindi nila mabigay lahat. But if our growth rate's high, I think there will be money to actually release it earlier, Madam Chair.
Salamat, Mr. Secretary. Mr. Chair, siyempre, gusto po ng healthcare workers natin, mabayaran po ito ng mas maaga, pero bilang sila rin po ay taxpayers, consumers, mahirap yung balancing act kasi in terms of additional taxes. Pero salamat po sa mga tanong nyo sa unang pagsang ito. Oh, and lastly po on the HEA, na-inform po ako na nag-establish ang department ng grievance board para investigahan yung failure ng pag-grant ng COVID-19 benefits at allowances sa eligible healthcare workers. Pwede po bang itanong paano itong grievance boards, paano nila ini-intend na i-address yung bottlenecks para sa wakas makuha na nga po nung HCWs natin yung ano yung due sa kanila?
Thank you, Madam Chair. Ang process po, the Department of Health has a list of the healthcare workers that are due their benefits, and then the money is allocated to the regional offices of the Department of Health, who then allocates them to the hospital based on the listing. So yung grievances are mostly people who are not paid, who were in the list or was removed by their director. So hindi sila makakomplain sa director nila. So they complain to our regional office. So yung regional directors namin ang mag-aano ng grievance committee, and we will settle it with the hospital director to make sure that those who really served in the COVID wards will be paid. The other grievance naman is nag-serve sila pero na-downgrade yung kanilang category from medium risk to low risk, which means smaller yung amount na natatanggap nila. So yun yung second ina-address namin, and we have made some amendments like security guards that in the front in the ER, parang in-upgrade namin sila so that they will get the correct benefits due them, Madam Chair.
Salamat, Mr. Secretary, at na-anticipate nyo yung isang follow-up question ko. So malinaw po sa akin na yung grievance boards ay nasa regional level pala dun sa regional offices nyo, and then pababa sila sa hospital para tugunan kung anumang grievance mayroon. And then bukod po dun sa binanggit nyo ng ilang amendments, security guards, ano pa yung ibang action points na ginagawa ng DOH para sa wakas i-address itong recurring issue ng HCW's allowances, kung meron pong ibang action points?
Yes, so because of those, Madam Chair, naisip namin na mag-create na diretso na lang sa ATM ng mga healthcare workers. So nakikipag-usap kami sa Land Bank and DBP kung minsan kung may Land Bank account sila at DBP account sila, kasi ma'am, nasa private hospitals ito. So some of them don't have that. So that was the other process that would simplify it, na hindi na dadaan sa hospital director at diretso sa bank account ng ating mga workers. So pinag-aaralan ito. I think yung iba pumayag, nag-set up ng Land Bank accounts. Tapos meron kaming dashboard din na sinet up, parang website na pwedeng puntahan, doh.gov.ph, at may quick link doon para makita nila kung anong status ng HEA.
Salamat po, Secretary. At sana kung mag-workout po yung pag-uusap ng department nyo sa Land Bank at DBP, mapag-isipan din paano naman yung provision sa mga private hospital workers, lalo na po gaya ng sinabi nyo na walang account dito sa mga government banks natin. Salamat, Secretary. Dako ako sa pangalawang paksa ko, yung COA findings sa Pharmaly scandal. During my interpellation of the budget of the Commission on Audit, I followed up on their audit of DOH's procurement of COVID-19 supplies involving the procurement service of the DBM and Pharmaly Pharmaceutical Corporation. Some of the findings I was made aware of include non-compliance of DOH to MOA requirements for the transfer of funds amounting to 47.65 billion pesos, failure of DOH to provide PSDBM complete technical specifications and other relevant standards or requirements on COVID-19 items in the agency's procurement requests, failure of DOH to appropriately exercise administrative control in ensuring the availability of PPEs and medical supplies, and failure of DOH to exert efforts in monitoring the liquidation of the 47B plus pesos funds transferred to PSDBM. Matanong lang po, ang good secretary po ba made aware po nitong COA findings na ito?
Yes, Madam Chair, we were made aware of this, and we will try to comply whatever legal processes will continue thereafter. So susunod po tayo sa batas, Madam Chair.
Salamat po, Sir Secretary. At dahil dumako na rin po tayo dun sa usapin ng compliance, aware po ba ang DOH management sa mga COA recommendations para i-address itong adverse findings? Paano po yung DOH management nag-i-intend na ipatupad itong mga rekomendasyon para hindi na maulit muli ang mga irregularidad na ito? Lalo't higit ay maibalik ang pondong hindi nagamit na nananatili pang nakalagak sa PSDBM.
Yes, yes, Madam Chair. Meron tayong ongoing case then with the Ombudsman regarding this after the Senate investigations. So we will comply. And then we've also asked our own audit to actually do audit of all those that were procured during that time, Madam Chair.
Ah, okay po. So bukod pa po sa special audit ng COA, ang DOH audit ay magsasagawa rin ng sarili niyang audit. Alright, salamat po, Mr. Secretary. And huli po sa paksang ito, fully aware of the role that the good secretary as an advisor to the National Task Force on COVID-19, paano niyo po, Secretary, ini-intend na singilin yung accountability mula sa mga DOH officials na involved sa massive failure na ito na proteksyon na ng mga public funds at halos na kompromiso yung ating COVID-19 prevention and control?
Madam Chair, with regards to those findings, we will allow the court to make the decision, maybe the Sandigan or Ombudsman in Sandigan, and we will comply with whatever decision these bodies come out with, Madam Chair.
Salamat, Secretary. At the same time, sabi niyo kanina, magkoconduct ang DOH ng sarili niyang audit. So based sa mga posibleng findings at recommendation na iyon, meron ba kayong kinocontemplate na mga posibleng paraan moving forward, both to exact accountability for the recent past at saka para siguruhin yung higit pang accountability moving forward?
Yes, Madam Chair, we will do that. We will actually try to improve our processes so these incidents will not happen in the future, Madam Chair.
Salamat, Secretary. Ngayon, gusto kong magtanong ng ilang mga tanong tungkol sa mga tinawag na questionable conduct. Good Secretary, you've been involved in quite a few controversies in which you voiced out your opinions or shared something on social media. Some of them were your remarks during the height of the pandemic in 2020 against the community pantry, such as death by community pantry, and I told you so about the death of Orlando de la Cruz, who collapsed while queuing for actor Angel Locsin's community pantry in Quezon City. In a statement made by the UP Department of English and Comparative Literature on 23rd April 2021, it was said that your remarks regarding community pantries, specifically of their proponent, Ana Patricia Non, were dangerous and malignant. It was further stated that your baseless questioning of quote-unquote kapatreng and may kulay ka ba o wala insinuated that Ms. Non was part of the Communist Party of the Philippines. Another one was a screenshot of an anecdote you shared on your Facebook account in October 2020, in which a father is comparing rape, romance, and marriage to his son. Quote, the father in the story noted that clothes is the mere difference among the three, saying, in rape, you tear the clothes, in romance, you remove the clothes, in marriage, you wash the clothes. And quote, Ebosa captioned this with, laughter is the best medicine. I saw, Mr. Secretary, that you already tried to make amends by tendering your resignation at UP and posting public apologies on these matters. But today, can the good secretary comment on this, considering that you're being appointed as the head of an executive department and your statements about healthcare workers, the community pantries, and red tagging were criticized for being insensitive and offensive?
Thank you very much, Madam Chair. For the joke that I posted, I was immediately informed by our gender and women's studies to take it down. And within 2 hours, I actually took it down. And I think the spread was more of the people who captured it and recirculated it. I also underwent gender sensitivity training for a day with the head herself of the gender and women's studies because of this post. For the community pantry, I actually resigned as executive vice president of the University of the Philippines because of the response against my post, and I made a formal apology, and I continue to apologize for that statement and respect the rights of people who want to actually get food or give food to people that need in time of epidemic like what happened to us, Madam Chair. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you, Secretary. And can this honorable body have your commitment not to repeat such conduct?
I have already learned early on as in the past few days that any comment the Secretary of Health makes on media is already taken as policy. So I will be very careful and worried regarding these lessons I have learned in the past, Madam Chair.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary. And lastly, on this important topic, you said earlier that you continue to apologize for these statements and actions.
That is correct. Because now I've learned the value of respecting women, number two, and also for community pantries, respecting the rights of people who are expressing their opinions, Madam Chair.
Salamat po, Mr. Secretary. If I have more time, Mr. Chair, I think Mr. Chair at San Francis would like to interject.
Before we recognize Senator Tolentino, since we recognize the online presence of Senator Cynthia Villar and Senator Grace Po, may we recognize on the part of the Senate, Senator Chis Escudero, Senator Nancy Binay, Senator J.B. Hercito, Senator Rizan Tumero, Senator Tolentino, and from the House of Representatives, Congressman J.J. Romaldo, Congressman Gasataya, Congressman J.P. Pajernos, Congressman our Vice Chair Ramon Guico, our Majority Floor Leader, Congressman L. Ray Villafuerte, Congressman Johnny Pimentel, Congressman Dante Marcoleta, Congresswoman Lani Mercado, at Congressman Virginel Piron, Congressman Abet Garcia. May we now, akong GP, na mention ko po. Congressman GP Pajernos. May we now recognize Senator Tolentino.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just a few quick questions addressed to the nominee. I was in a huddle a while ago with our good friend Congressman Johnny Pimentel. December 2, 10:37 p.m. between 7.4 to 7.6 magnitude earthquake hit Surigao. May we know from the good secretary how much is the quick reaction funds of the department right now?
I know the allocated is 500 million QRF. That's a QRF. And to be released, Mr. Chair, we need a state of calamity to be declared, and then the funds can be released to the specific area.
So before a state of calamity can, before the funds can be released, a state of calamity has to be declared. But may we know from the good secretary, has there been an emergency assistance given to Surigao del Sur, Hinatuan in particular, since December 2? December ano na po ba ngayon? December 5 na. And I was informed by Congressman Johnny Pimentel that 600 aftershocks were registered. May mga namatay po, pero hindi pa ho umaalis yung mga kababayan natin sa Surigao sa mga evacuation centers, nanginginig, natatakot, kinakabahan, baka sila na yung susunod. So, ang tanong ko po, has there been a plan to mobilize mental health professionals? They call this CIST. Ano po yung CISD?
Critical
Incident Stress Debriefers. Nagplano na ba ho? Pumunta na? May ticket na ng aeroplano? O hintayin pa natin yung declaration ng state of calamity? Kasi sabi ni Congressman Johnny Pimentel, nakailan ho kanina ngayong umaga? Madaling araw, meron na naman, 7.3. So wala na ho itong katapusan. And they need the assistance of the Department of Health. May we know your answer, my good friend, Dr. Herbosa.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. We were monitoring this earthquake together with the director of the Health Emergency Management Bureau. we actually, I have in the region 10.4 million that is pre-positioned for, you know, calamities and disasters. And we are releasing another 33.4 million for the logistics and supplies of the region. We are in coordination with the regional director, and they have not requested additional supplies.
They have not requested yet.
Not yet.
But can it be done motu proprio? Oh. Kasi nakikita naman natin na talagang yung ganitong 7.4 to 7.6 sa Afghanistan lang nangyari to, sa Iran o sa Nepal. Pero ito ngayon, nasa hinatuan na. So, can you do it even without a request emanating from your regional director?
That is correct, Mr. Chair. Actually, standard po, meron tayong psychosocial health workers that actually address. Kasama po sa disaster plan yan. So, pag nanghingi sila ng additional, then we mobilize the National Center for Mental Health to actually send. So, again, judgment of the people on the ground to request. So, but if you want, we will verify. If there is really need, we can send a team to Hinatuan for the psychosocial debriefing and CISD.
The reason why I raised that, Mr. Chairman, is because this is a reflection of how our good secretary, once confirmed, would react not just to earthquakes but future calamities involving typhoons, tsunamis, among others. So, ito siguro yung ano nyo, try run nyo, Mr. Secretary. So, the people of Surigao del Sur are waiting. Congressman Johnny Pimentel here is nodding. Siguro, hinihintay niya kung ano yung magiging action mo ng kagawaran, even without your confirmation yet. Kasi December 2, ngayon ay December 5 na, 72 hours elapsed. Naghihintay pa rin sila. I hope you can act quickly, my good friend, Secretary Herbosa.
Yes, Mr. Chair, we will send the psychosocial team to Hinatuan. Congressman Johnny knows I support the province of Surigao del Sur. I've been doing surgical missions there for even before I was a secretary.
No, but this one is different. This is an earthquake. Maraming salamat po, Mr. Chairman.
Salamat sa Senator Tol Tolentino. Senator Riza, do you have?
Salamat kayo, Mr. Chair. Mr. Secretary, ilang tanong po dun sa transfer of PhilHealth supervision to the Office of the President. Under the DOH's Department Order Number 2023-2606, dated 12 May 2023, a joint technical working group was created for the proposed transfer of PhilHealth to the Office of the President. As stated in the order, the functions of the TWG are revisit laws and issuances pertaining to the creation, mandates, and functions of the PhilHealth, assess technical and strategic aspects of the proposal, call resource persons from concerned offices, and submit a comprehensive report with the recommendations to the OP. However, nothing was mentioned about the context and rationale behind this proposal. So, pwede niyo po bang ibahagi yung rationale sa likod ng panukalang ito?
Thank you, Madam Chair. Unfortunately, I was not privy to the rationale for this because this happened prior to my appointment as Secretary of Health on June 5. But I received the report of the technical working group and transmitted it to the Office of the President. And in that report, they see no legal impediment in the transfer. However, the composition of the board requires legal amendments because the chair of the board is still the Secretary of Health. So that's written in the charter or the law of PhilHealth. So that has to be modified. As a personal view, ma'am, I see no value in transferring PhilHealth to the Office of the President since the alter ego of the President is anyway the Secretary of Health. So as long as it continues to perform its duties, that means paying the health benefits of its members, I think we should be able to be true to the mandate of the Charter of PhilHealth, Madam Chair.
Maraming salamat para doon, Secretary. I'm really glad to hear you say that. Kasi, tatanungin ko sana, okay, walang legal impediments, pero kayo, bilang secretary, bilang doktor pa, anong tingin nyo? And I really appreciate your take on this matter. Tama lang yon bilang secretary ng Department of Health at kayo po yung nagpapatupad ng universal healthcare law kung saan yung PhilHealth ay isang essential pillar of health financing and insurance. So, hindi ko na kailangan itanong yung ano yung underlying institutional issues ng PhilHealth at paano daw mareresolba yung mga yun sa paglipat ng supervision sa PhilHealth sa OP, ni yung tanong na paano yung proposed transfer i-improve yung performance at benefit delivery ng PhilHealth. Salamat sa pagbanggit nyo na yung improvement ng benefit delivery ay isang tatrabuhin pa ng department, particular sa pamamagitan ng PhilHealth. At yung pinakatanong ko sana, bago nyo sinabing you don't see any benefit in that transfer, ay bakit kinoconsider ng PhilHealth i-relinquish yung kanyang responsibilidad at accountability bilang principal national health authority in charge sa PhilHealth? Siguro huling tanong na lang, maybe as a way of lesson learned also moving forward, would you know kung yung mga key stakeholders na konsulta ng TWG, kasi noon iniulat na members of the medical community expressed their opposition to the proposed transfer, and there was also a claim then that Dr. Jose Rene De Grano, the president of the Private Hospitals Association of the Philippines, was not consulted.
Hindi ko alam yung mga detalya doon sa proseso, pero I also personally gave my views about this transfer to the Office of the Executive Secretary. At mukhang nasunod naman po, kasi hindi na-announce na ito ay ilipat sa Office of the President. So I think they are listening to the advice of the Secretary of Health, Madam Chair. Thank you.
I certainly hope so, Secretary, at kung ano ang kakailanganin para klaruhin ito sa publiko. I don't know what would... If it's an action by DOH regarding yung department personnel order ninyo noon, or just a final official announcement from the Office of the President para mapanatag ang loob. I'm sure kayo po sa executive, you'll know kung ano yung proper form of official communication dito.
Yes, so, Madam Chair, we'll comply. We will comply.
Salamat, good Secretary. So, huling paksa na lang po yung 2022 COA findings. Our reading of the COA audit report on the fiscal year 2022 funds of the DOH reveals three perennial issues of DOH. One, the low utilization of funds. Two, wastage of funds. And three, deficiencies in the procurement process. I wish to ask the Secretary some questions regarding these structural problems. But first, allow me please, Mr. Chair, to share some figures lifted from the 2022 COA audit report on DOH. So the Commission on Audit noted that DOH had low utilization of new appropriations from the fiscal year 2022 GAA and specific budgets in the continuing appropriations from fiscal year 2021. Under the fiscal year 2022 GAA, the DOH received total allotments worth 180.6 billion pesos. Of this amount, the department managed to obligate 156.9 billion pesos and disburse 122.4 billion pesos. This translates to an obligation rate of 87% and a disbursement rate of 78%. Maaari po bang malaman kung aware yung secretary sa mga figures na ito at kung na-brief na sila tungkol sa spending performance ng department?
Yes, Madam Chair, these were the first few things that came to me when I sat down as Secretary of Health, that there was very low budget utilization. And since then, I have instructed our department to go several ways forward and catch up with improve the Department of Health utilization. So we've tried to identify yung mga blocks in implementation, especially of infrastructure projects, yung modification. We also are trying to streamline our procedures and policies to accelerate all of this, and also in coordination with other agencies to improve the timing of fund releases. We also like to do better planning and early procurement activities. Ngayong May NEP na, we are actually starting our early procurement activities so that when the GAA is signed, these awards can already be given. So we've also, for this year, started to issue catch-up plans for budgets that have not yet been utilized and monitor all these projects. So hopefully we can streamline all of this. I've been trying to tell them one of the things I'd like to see is an asset management system. That means from procurement all the way to disposal, we can procure vaccines, medicines on time and be delivered to the people on time, Madam Chair. Thank you.
Salamat, Secretary. I really hope all of these plans materialize. At sa pamamagitan siguro pangunahin ng catch-up plans. And just relating it to the first question that we discussed earlier, Secretary, So I'm looking forward also na kasama sa catch-up plans yung pagbayad nga po ng HEA sa mga healthcare workers natin by 2026 at the latest, or hopefully earlier. So dahil na-brief po ang secretary, sabi nyo nga among the first few things na naging aware kayo bilang secretary, mari rin po ba malaman yung latest budget utilization figures ng DOH kaugnay ng 2022 continuing appropriations at fiscal year 2023 new appropriations, kung meron na pong figures na ito?
Alam ko, ma'am, yung ating 2022 ay nasa 90%, 99% almost already yung CONAP 2022. And for the current year, 2023, as of November 15, 2 weeks ago po, 74% na ang aming disbursement rate. 74%. Sa CONAP, ang disbursement, ang obligation ang mataas, ang disbursement, remaining CONAP is 65% po ang na-utilize na, na-disburse na. So ang grand total namin for disbursement for this, for the CONAP and the current year is 73% as of November 15, Madam Chair.
So confident naman po kayo na sa loob nitong natirang buwan ng taong ito ay madi-disburse na rin po yung balance of 27%?
Yes, Madam Chair. I was told parang bumibilis pagdating ng November, December ang utilization. Talagang hinahabol po, Madam Chair.
Salamat, Secretary. So, huling tanong ko po ngayong umaga, if we look at the specific funds, COA flagged several PAPs of DOH which posted low fund utilization or low disbursement rates. Some of the programs that have disbursement rates lower than 50% include the Cancer Assistance Fund, 15.7%, the Philippine COVID-19 Emergency Response Project, 18.5%, the one of the most important Health Facilities Enhancement Program, HFEP, 34.3%, the Health System Enhancement to Address and Limit COVID-19, a measly 0.11%, and ito, napaka-importante rin po sa amin bilang mga kababaihan, Family Health, Immunization, Nutrition, and Responsible Parenting, 18.1%. So, huling mga tanong po, is the aware po ba ang Secretary sa status nitong mga programa? As far as I know, these are major and urgent programs of DOH. Alam po ba ng Secretary yung mga dahilan sa likod ng low fund utilization ng DOH sa mga ito?
Yes, Madam Chair. For the Cancer Assistance Funds, late po na-release yung SARO. By September lang po kami na-releasean. So, after that, na-utilize na. Yung sa HPEP, Madam Chair, it's mostly modifications. Because sometimes there are funds allocated to a health center. Tapos may nauna na palang funds na ni-release yung local government. So, papalipat nila yun to another health center that needs it. So, yun yung natatagalan, and that's the one causing some of our delay. The other one is may pond, the other ones are things that were allocated to the DOH but we were not included in the planning. Ito, ma'am, yung mga insertions. So later namin nakukuha, wala pa palang detailed architectural and engineering designs. So hinahabol na lang namin yon. We catch up for those. So yan ang mga a few of the things I know that have caused the delay and low budget utilization and part ng catch up plan namin. That the future HPEP magamit talaga, tapos yung sa mga cancer funds, early procurement activities at bilisan. At nagpadagdag na po ako, Madam Chair, ng mga teams, more bids and awards teams so that we can utilize the many funds that is allocated by the legislature to the Department of Health, Madam Chair.
Salamat, Secretary. At huli, yung delay sa disbursement dun sa line item na kasama yung responsible parenting, alam po ba kung bakit nasa 18.1% lamang?
If I'm not mistaken, there was a problem with the procurement of the for the birth control pills because of a certain component, but we were able to fix it legally, Madam Chair. So na-issue na rin yung disbursement, not Madam Chair.
All right. Maraming salamat, Secretary. Dagan salamat, Mr. Chair.
Salamat po, Senator Risa. Senator Chis may recognize Senator Escudero.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just one policy question, Secretary Ted. What's your position on the NDA signed by the previous administration with respect to the acquisition of the vaccine? And have you submitted to COVID the full liquidation of the funds utilized and used for the vaccine?
Mr. Chair, I think the non-disclosure was requested by the vaccine companies.
I'm not talking about who requested it, Mr. Secretary. I'm asking what your position is. Because still under our constitution, under our laws, there is no such thing as a procurement that the price will not be revealed to COA. Because these are public funds. I've faced two secretaries already and both took a different position. So may I ask you now as the new secretary, what position do you take and will you take insofar as these NDAs signed by your predecessors are concerned?
Mr. Chair, I believe public funds are auditable, and they should, that COA should be able to see the prices at which these products were procured.
Mr. Have you given it to COA, sir?
Not yet. They haven't asked me for.
So if, these are.
Is there a process?
These are 2020, 2021 disbursements during the pandemic. By now, it should have been given. You are well aware of that, insofar as liquidations of expenses are concerned. For example, the COA report for 2022 is already done. It was used for the budget deliberations for the different agencies. So I'm talking year 2020, 2021, 2022. And in the 2022 report, it was not there. So, sir, please.
I've been informed that it's already been submitted to COA, all the prices of the commodities, Mr. Chair.
All of the acquisitions?
Yes, kindly, Mr. Chair.
Can you kindly submit the same two to this committee? Meaning to say, how many vaccines did we buy, at what price, at different times of the year that we bought it? And an inventory of the vaccines too, sir. Meaning, ilan yung nag-expire, ilan yung dinagamit, ilan ba yung nandyan, anong balak natin gawin. Just a report on that, sir.
Yes, Mr. Chair, we will comply.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary. Thank you, Dad. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Salamat, Senator Chis. May we recognize Congressman Johnny Pimentel for his manifestation of support.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I have no questions, but I would like to manifest my support to my good friend, Secretary Ted Herbosa. I have known him for the past 28 years. I first met him when I was Vice Governor of Surigao del Sur. He was then a member of the Physicians for Peace, and he did several medical missions. And through the years, Mr. Chair, I found Secretary Ted Herbosa has a very compassionate heart in helping our people. With his expertise and experience, I truly believe that he will be an asset to this administration. I think he is a very, very much a capable leader. And I believe that he fits all the requirements to become the head of the Department of Health. So, Mr. Chair, I give my full support to Secretary Ted Herbosa on his ad interim appointment. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Salamat, Kong Johnny. May we recognize Senator J.B. Hercito, and then after our Vice Chair.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Mr. Secretary, morning again. We wish you all the luck. We still have a lot of challenges that we have to surmount in our quest to have a genuine universal health care. As you know, during the last two Congresses, we passed several landmark legislations in the Senate. One is the universal health care, mula sakit, National Integrated Cancer Control Act. And first of all, I'd like to thank you for that you said that you will deeply, that you will really support the full implementation of these landmark health legislations. And you further said that the UAC would need intervention and reforms, no, for it to be fully implemented. Can you state for the record, Mr. Secretary, what intervention or reforms in the health sector do you intend to introduce, and if have you already begun such?
Yes, Mr. Chair, we will implement the primary care, the development of primary care facilities in the Philippines. We've already targeted about 600 to be built, 150 are under construction. Well, also, we want to improve benefit primary care benefit packages like consulta, which is mandated by the Universal Healthcare Law, so that our citizens will not be going to hospital emergency departments, but will go to primary care centers for services not requiring the hospital. And of course, we also have to build the network of specialty hospitals for our citizens all over the country, not only in Metro Manila, but in the regions where heart operations and other specialty operations are also required. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary. That's good to know. And likewise, as the principal author of this measure, I know that you're one of those advocates that really supported the passage of this landmark legislation. But still, there are still a lot of challenges for its realization. And just like to ask, in your short stint, as a secretary, what are you think the challenges that we have to surmount in order for us to be able to fully implement and realize a genuine healthcare?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I think the biggest problem is the integration of the health system, because as you very well know, our local government code actually decentralized the health system. And this is where we suffered when we decentralized. So the UHC law, when I read it, it talks about integration of health services. So this we will try to do. In fact, one of the statements I've given in Congress was to build a DOH hospital in each province, because we're now running 87 hospitals. Yet there are only 83 provinces. And yet when I look at the list, there are many provinces wherein they have to travel 2 hours to go to the DOH hospital. So in the places that they need it, we will have the DOH hospital will become the apex, and it will help integrate the services in the primary care, in the district hospital, in the provincial hospital. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
And last but not least, Mr. Chair, you mentioned of specialty hospitals. This is very, I think this was mentioned also by the President in his first two SONAS as a priority. In fact, we already passed that under our chair here, the measure on specialty centers. And last year, we allocated, I think, $4 billion, if I'm not mistaken, and added another $2 billion. For 2024, there will be $10.2 billion that will be allocated for specialty centers. My question, Secretary, how the challenge here is the utilization. No? That's medyo malaki po yung $10 billion. Can you state for the record how do you plan to utilize this so that hindi po masayang itong nilagay natin $10 billion, so that the dream or the intention of our President and the Senate and the Congress for us to be able to have the specialty centers up and running as soon as possible time. Yung $10 billion ba, kaya po natin magastos, magamit para po sa lalong madaling panahon, magamit ka agad itong specialty centers?
Yes, Mr. Chair, magagamit lahat po yan, kasi yung mga specialty centers require very expensive equipment, cancer center, yung heart center, yung mga kidney center, this require expensive equipment. In fact, ang stumbling block po, hindi yung pera, because it's allocated na nga. Ang stumbling block is training the specialist. So ang nangyayari, like, nagtayo kami ng heart center sa Cagayan de Oro, sa Northern Mindanao. In the beginning, pumupunta pa yung taga-heart center para mag-operate ng cases. Pero ngayon, nakasustain na sila kasi may graduates na from heart center that are doing the operation there. So, ganun din sa Vicente Soto, sa Cebu, nung umpisa pumupunta doon, but now they're doing their own heart operation, and also in Davao. So, ito yung proseso. We will be training people also that will eventually provide these services to those. And sabi nga nung isang congressman sa akin, ang hirap yung pinapapunta pa sa Manila yung family for these operations in heart center. But it's very easy kung doon sa province mismo ginagawa, Mr. Chair. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Secretary. We wish you all the best. No? It's good to know that your plans. Medyo marami tayong challenges, Mr. Chair, lalo na rin specialty centers, training of the specialists in the respective areas, no, where the specialty centers will be established. So we wish you all the luck. Mr. Secretary. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Salamat, Senator JB. Si Senator JB po ang principal sponsor ng Universal Healthcare Law no during the 17th Congress. Kaya napaka-importante po yan kay Senator JB. And then nung 18th Congress naman po, ako bilang inyong chairman po ng Committee on Health, alam niyo yung challenge sa panahon ng pandemya at naging party ka po dyan, Secretary Herbosa, kaya ako full support po sa inyo. Andyan po yung continuity ng mga programs po ng ating Department of Health. And speaking about the Regional Specialty Centers, Republic Act 11959, papasalamat po ako sa mga kasama natin sa Kongreso at sa Senado. At proud po akong banggitin sa inyo na 24-0 po ang boto nito dito sa Senado dahil alam nilang makakatulong po ito sa mga kababayan nating mga mahirap bilang inyong principal sponsor at co-author. At priority po ito ni Pangulong Bongbong Marcos, priority po ito ni Senate President Migs Zubiri bilang kanyang promise noong nakaraang taon. At nabanggit po parati na hindi lang naman po sa Metro Manila yung may karamdaman ng sakit sa puso, lung, cancer, kidney, neonatal, mental. 17 po itong specialty centers na ating inaprubahan kung saan po i-institutionalize natin sa multi-year plan of the government kung saan po pwede nang operahan sa puso, halimbawa sa Zamboanga. Hindi na nila kailangan bumiyahe rito sa Metro Manila from Tacloban. Doon na po operahan sa mga existing DOH regional hospitals. At masaya rin po ako na yearly no nagkakaroon po ng increase ang budget nito from 6 billion sa 2023. Next year ang proposed budget is about 10 billion and pagdating po ng 2025 ang plano po ng DOH I heard ay through another source no mas tataas pa pupondohan pa. At magamit po kaagad yung pondo sa pagpapatayo ng mga specialty centers sa mga existing DOH hospitals. So asahan nyo po bilang inyong chairman ng Committee on Health, susuporta po ako rito na ma-implement po ito ng maayos itong multi-year plan ng ating gobyerno. Kaya po natin isinabatas Republic Act 11959. And before we recognize Congressman Marcoleta. Sir, isang ano lang po, merong lumalapit rin po sa amin ditong mga pasyente na natatanggihan po sa mga hospitals. Ano bang step ang ginagawa ninyo rito? Lalo-lalo na po yung mga cases na emergency cases na di ba bawal pong tanggihan sila?
Yes, Mr. Chair, bawal pong tanggihan sila, lalo na kung emergency cases. Pero kung non-emergency po, talagang nililipat kung puno po yung Department of Health Hospital. So, ini-improve namin yung tinatawag na patient navigation, yung paglipat. At para hindi na sila masayang yung oras, dumiretso doon sa hospital na tatanggap talaga sa kanila. May sistema nang nagawa na ganito sa Region 7 at gusto ko sana mapalaganap ito sa lahat ng region. Para hindi na nag-hospital hopping yung ating mga pasyente at diretso na dun sa hospital na tatanggap mismo sa kanila.
Do you have any hotline or desk for this concerns po, Secretary?
Meron tayo sa bawat region. Sa bawat region po. Kasi nung COVID, yun yung ating one referral center. Kinonvert na po namin yan to patient navigation and referral system. Yung iba active, yung iba hindi. So, siguro ayusin natin yan, Mr. Chair, para walang pasyenteng matatanggihan sa public hospital.
Salamat, Secretary. May we recognize Congressman Rodante Marcoleta for his manifestation of support.
Maraming salamat, Mr. Chair. I want to make of record by way of manifestation that I really support the appointment or confirmation of Secretary Ted Herbosa, and also to make of record that I'm happy to make a report to you, Mr. Chair, that we arrived at a sort of a modus vivendi. As a matter of fact, I furnished him a draft of an IRR, which I thought is basically premise on the law itself. And in texting back, he agreed that he will comply. The second point is conference of parties number 10 to the World Health Organization and the framework control on tobacco, which will take place in Panama next year, Mr. Chair. And I also texted Secretary Herbosa that I think there is a need for a unifying statement that will be provided or articulated by the Philippine government as a state party, considering that there are agencies that will attend that particular Congress in Panama, namely the DOH, the DFA, even the DTI, and a representative from the House or Congress. Kaya importante po na mayroong general statement that will come from the DOH in order to unify or to articulate a unified statement that are based on acts of Congress, meaning to say, based on the law. Pumayag naman po si Sec. Herbosa, so ang akin pong tingin ay pipirmahan niya yung another general statement na ibibigay ko sa kanya prior to his confirmation today, Mr. Chair. Is my presumption correct, Secretary Herbosa?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you to Congressman Marcoleta for enlightening me regarding the law on the vape. So we will comply with the implementation and operationalization of Section 12K of Republic Act 11900, and we'll also have a common position for the Framework Convention of Parties of the Framework Convention and Tobacco Control of WHO. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Salamat po, Mr. Chair.
Salamat po, Congressman Marcoleta, sa iyong suporta po. May we recognize our Vice Chair, Congressman Guico, for his manifestation of support.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. This is a manifestation of support for the confirmation of the ad interim appointment of Secretary Teodoro Herbosa of the Department of Health. I fully support the confirmation of Secretary Teodoro Herbosa as our new Secretary of Health. A veteran in the field of medicine, not only is he rich in professional experience, but also has the will and determination to pursue innovative solutions in addressing the most pressing problems with regards to our health sector. May the good Secretary succeed in all his good efforts. Thank you, Mr. Secretary.
May we recognize Congressman G.P. Pajeros.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. This is not a question, Mr. Chair. This is a manifestation of support. Good morning, Mr. Chair, at sa lahat po na nandito. Masasabi po natin na minsan pong naglingkod na bilang Health Undersecretary ang ating pong nominee mula po 2010 hanggang 2015 sa ilalim po ng administrasyon ni former President Aquino. Paragdagan din po rito, ang ating nominee ay nanungkulan rin bilang advisor ng National Task Force sa ilalim ng administrasyon ng ating pong former President Rodrigo Duterte sa pagpuksa ng coronavirus dito po sa ating bansa simula 2020 at 2021. Dahil po dito at sa kanyang mga nagawa na sa departamento at mga kabutihan pa para sa ating mga kababayan, binibigay ko po ang buong suporta ko sa appointment ng ating nominee bilang Secretary of Health. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Salamat. May we recognize Congressman Biron for his manifestation of support.
Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This representation fully support the confirmation of our Secretary. But, Sec, if you recall, one of our policy discussions involved the problem of this government that to date we lack 150,000 beds, short of what is prescribed by the World Health Organization. And I believe that in one of those discussions, I even suggested that if we can adopt the Turkish model, where government doesn't have to spend money, capital expenditure is limited because government opted to undertake a PPP with existing private operators of health centers. And I think that model might be applicable in the Philippines, considering the lack of funds, that not even in our lifetime that we'll be able to meet this shortage of hospital beds. So I hope that in your tenure for the next 5 years, you would seriously consider this particular option. Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you, Mr. Secretary.
May we recognize Congressman Abed Garcia for his manifestation of support.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and good morning to our colleagues, kay Secretary Herbosa. In solidarity with the House position, hindi na po ako magtatanong kay Secretary, and I would like to manifest my support for the confirmation of the good Secretary. I believe that his vast experience, knowledge, and dedication with regards to health will make him competent at the helm of the Department of Health. Gusto ko lang po i-reiterate yung aming concern sa lalawigan ng Bataan with regards to the Republic Act 11453 or the expansion of powers of the Freeport area of Bataan. Gusto ko lang pong paliwanag, because of in-country migration, it really causes disruption with the health, education, and all the sectors in communities around the country. Pinag-uusapan po natin kanina yung distribution of health facilities all around the country. Pero tingnan din po natin kung saan pumupunta yung migration, where the economic activities are located and these people are seeking jobs. And they cause much disruption in the locality. So yung mga workers po dito sa Freeport ay hindi lang po taga Bataan, kundi taga Mindanao, taga Visayas, taga Southern, Central, and Northern Luzon. So imagine thousands of workers coming in. It will really cause a major disruption in all the sectors, particularly yung health sector. That's why the wisdom of the law ng Republic Act 11453 is really for DOH to put up a tertiary hospital. And I think pumasa na po sa legal ng DOH, and I hope ma-implement na po ito. Having said that, again, I would like to reiterate my support for the confirmation of the good secretary as Department Secretary of the DOH. Maraming salamat, Mr. Chair. Thank you.
Salamat. I would like to recognize Congressman Gasataya.
Thank you, Honorable Chair. Magandang umaga sa lahat. I'd like to manifest also my support for the confirmation of Secretary Herbosa. I'd like to reiterate also that he has been giving his full commitment for the implementation of the Republic Act, which there's a presentation authored together with the good Chair, Senator Go, for the implementation or the construction of the Bacolod City General Hospital. We'd like to manifest our appreciation and like to mention that this is a very important law which will help the city of Bacolod, and also his commitment to address the concerns of health workers in Bacolod which were not able to receive their HEA, as well as the commitment of the good secretary that they will consider Corazon Locsin Hospital to also be a specialty hospital on that part of the country, Honorable Chair. So maraming salamat at magandang umaga po.
Wala na po. I would like to recognize and thank Senator Nancy Binay and Senator Rizon Tuberos. Kahit hindi na po mandatory ang pagsusuot ng face mask, suot nyo pa rin face mask. And of course, Senator Tol Tolentino. At sa lahat po ng mga Department of Health officials natin, no, susuot pa rin sila ng face mask. Salamat sa inyong sakripisyo
lahat po ng mga USECs, USEC David, USEC Ferrere, USEC Ronquillo, USEC Taino, USEC Tayag, ating dancing doctor, USEC Laksamana, USEC Balboa, ang lahat po ng mga ASEC Gorgolon, Sharit. Go ahead.
Since nabanggit mo yung pagsusuot ng mask, siguro gusto ko lang tanongin kay Secretary kung nire-recommenda niya ulit para sa ating mga kababayan ang pagsusuot muli ng mask, kasi di ba meron yung sakit na tinatamaan ng mga bata ngayon sa China, and alam naman natin na parang may upsurge ngayon ng COVID. Mismo ang ating presidente, positive ngayon. Dito sa Senado, ilang kasamahan din namin ng positive. So, siguro yun lang gusto natin marinig kay Secretary Herbosa.
Go ahead, dear Secretary.
Thank you, Madam Chair. We recommend optional wearing of masks for people who are high risk, elderly people in places which are enclosed, kagaya itong meeting room na to na maraming tao. It would be a good practice to also wear your mask, especially if you are prone to illnesses. And then, of course, yung children, pag may sakit sila, wag na silang papasukin. Let them stay at home so that they will not infect the other children. It is really the season for respiratory illness. Maraming party, maraming Christmas celebration, at kuminsan nagkakawan. Kung kayo naman may ubo sipon, huwag na kayong mag-attend ng party. Kasi baka mahawad yung pa yung ibang members of the part of that celebration. And then, of course, talagang let's watch our health. Reminders to all our people during Christmas season. Pareho pa rin, kung ano yung bawal sa inyo, bawal pa rin po. Kasi maraming sinasabi na this is the time of the year. Once lang, kakain sila ng bawal sa kanila. Nauuwi sila sa ospital po.
I agree with you, Secretary Ted. Kung hindi naman po sagabal sa ating mga kababayan na magsuot ng face mask, magsuot pa rin kayo. Then, delikado ang panahon ngayon. Tumataas talaga yung kaso ng influenza at yung mga high risk nga po, delikado. So, salamat sa iyong concern, Secretary Ted Herbosa, at sa lahat ng mga kababayan natin. Mga empleyado po ng DOH, salamat po sa inyong suporta sa ating mga kababayan. Are there any other members who would want to ask questions of to the Secretary? If there are none, may we call on our majority floor leader?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Kaya po walang mask ang mga congressman dahil pinamigay na po namin lahat ng mga mask namin sa aming mga kababayan. Mr. Chair, I move to recommend to the plenary for the commission to confirm the ad interim appointment of Mr. Teodoro Javier Herbosa as Secretary of the Department of Health.
There is a motion to recommend to the plenary for the commission to confirm the ad interim appointment of Secretary Teodoro Javier Herbosa as Secretary of the Department of Health. Is there any objection? There being none, the same is hereby approved. Majority Floor Leader.
Mr. Chair, there being no other matters to discuss, I move to adjourn the meeting.
On motion of the Majority Floor Leader, Julie seconded. There being no objection, the meeting is hereby adjourned.
I'll call the new manager. Thank you.